technology is something to me that has this huge potential. Blockchain happens to be the one today that I see as being a generational change. Kind of like the internet in its early days, this presents a big opportunity. It's a platform for new application development, not just an application in and of itself.
We're really just at the beginning of what we could do with blockchain.
The future is not yet written. We have to show up together and create that collective voice to create that better tomorrow. It's ours to lose.
I think we've got some big challenges to overcome as an industry, and my fears are that those are gonna take longer than we hope. What's really hopeful is that we have the best and brightest from the most exciting technology companies in the world dedicating themselves to this space.
Driving every corner of our global economy is code. In this series, we look under the hood at today's most dynamic open source software with the people behind it.
Blockchain at its most fundamental is a distributed ledger. It's a record of transactions that's hosted on many nodes. Getting one step deeper, consensus is this algorithmic process that allows those nodes to all agree on the next block of data that should be written to them.
Blockchain's one of those technologies that's taken the industry by storm. People see applications of it everywhere. But there's a lot of misconceptions behind what blockchain is. Many people associate blockchain with cryptocurrencies, which is where it originated, where miners all around the world are providing the proof of work that guarantees the integrity of the information in the blockchain. We're here in Seattle, down in South Lake Union, to talk with T-Mobile, and we'll actually look at how they're using blockchain in a private consortium with new kinds of distributed agreement protocols in order to create solutions that are relevant to their business and the businesses that they interact with.
I'm Chris Spanton, and I'm a principal architect at T-Mobile. At T-Mobile, I worked to build our identity management systems that allowed our cloud infrastructure to grow and scale in the way that was required for our business. It was through that as I started to look forward to the future and the next generation of that infrastructure, that I looked at blockchain as a technology that could improve on what we're doing today and allow us to dramatically increase the transparency around auditing and governance of that identity infrastructure.
So Chris, we're building this solution with directories and NoSQL databases. Can you describe that system in a little bit more detail?
This is the next identity project. We've taken a Hyperledger Sawtooth blockchain and paired that with a NoSQL database. And that combination gives us the ability to do input processing through smart contracts onto the blockchain, and then output that to the NoSQL, where we get all those benefits of high-speed read and data validation processing, right? The analytics that you want for a business at the end of the day. And looking to integrate that with Active Directory and Azure Active Directory means we had to build together unique pipelines to do the transform processes and get data in from one and out to the other.
Why'd you select Sawtooth? What are the various things that you considered?
Yeah, Sawtooth is really unique. It's one of the Hyperledger project blockchains, but what it does uniquely is it leverages the POET consensus algorithm. Mm-hmm. POET is proof of elapsed time. You can leverage hardware to do consensus in a way that doesn't exist in public chains in a private chain. And so we've partnered with folks like Microsoft, where you run SGX chips, yes, in hardware. Then we can go take our workload, run it in the Azure cloud, and take advantage of that hardware backing it to have a more efficient consensus process.
Now, that the thing that you're mentioning there, that speed, is critical. That's a very important aspect of a decision about whether to use a public blockchain or a private one. Are there downsides to it from your perspective?
There's downsides or trade-offs that you look at on either side of that equation. You know, on the private side, we have the ability to apply permissions. So whereas with a public ledger, everybody sees the same copy of the same data, in a private ledger, you can actually say, you know, we need the accounting department to see some information, and we need the sales department to see other information. And that is a really important dynamic that allows us to implement solutions that operate in the way our business needs to operate. What was it you heard when we came to you with a need for working on this solution?
So I heard that you needed a solution that would work within T-Mobile, but also for companies more broadly to be able to control access to assets, right? How do I grant permission to things, but not just at the centralized IT function that we traditionally right. have had in the past, but saying, hey, I'm a business unit. I know the people who are working for me. I need to grant them access or I need to revoke access in a very simple way. I took all of that in and said, okay, I see what T-Mobile is trying to achieve, which is really a custom way to allow security to work and perform for their company.
How do you see the identity components of Azure and Azure Active Directory contributing to a blockchain-based solution like this?
All of the changes that take place within your directory are logged, right? Everyone has logging, but really, what is it about the visibility? What do you do with the log? There's literally millions of events in there. I join a group, I get added to some security role, or I get removed from a security role, right. which is even more important in some cases to make sure that from an access management perspective, people have only access to what they need to have access to.
And did you see anything unique with how this interfaced with the open source community and other businesses than T-Mobile?
Companies can acquire very complex solutions that scale to the enterprise, but what about other companies that are even smaller? Can they get the same level of service or capability from the open source world rather than trying to deploy some very complicated tool? And I think that's really compelling about what yeah. T-Mobile is doing with this open source project, is that anyone, regardless of the size of their company, can get the same level of capability that a major corporation like T-Mobile has.
What are some of the engineering decisions, Michael, that went into allowing that, you know, being simple enough for a small company but capable enough for a big company?
We utilize Docker containers, and this allows anybody to take our open source code and just run a simple command like Docker compose up after some configurations, and then they're able to have next running in a matter of minutes, really.
I think in the short term, what we're seeing is full enterprise architecture stacks having a blockchain layer in them. And we can look at the characteristics of a blockchain, things like immutability or non-repudiatable transactions or a decentralized topology, and say, hey, this is compelling in our stack. And look at how we can leverage that to build a solution that exhibits these characteristics. Investing today for us has been a great way to build our business and build solutions that exhibit new characteristics right now, but it's also a great way to see what the future looks like.
So, you know, here we are, Seattle. It's kind of this hotbed for new technologies, advanced things like blockchain. So as you see these new technologies kind of starting to emerge, how do you, as the leader of the group, think about how you're going to pursue it?
A lot of the innovation comes from within. And finding people that have a passion, a curiosity, they start that process. And part of our role is to help support that,
yep.
help provide the resources, the connectivity to other teams. Sometimes it's other companies to help that idea continue to grow and evolve.
You have an expectation that that innovation occurs kind of in the mainstream team. And that's it's just kind of part of what the mainstream teams are responsible for.
We brought product and technology together for that reason, because you have technologists, you have people driving ideas, and if you can eliminate friction between those teams and allow that yep. to happen, you're going to see innovation come from all different areas of the organization.
Why do you think we're seeing so much kind of innovation occurring now? Like, what's special?
So I think now is an exciting time, because the convergence of all of these technologies opens up new opportunities we haven't even thought about. If I go back 10 years and the thought of using a phone to get in a car with a complete stranger who's going to drop me off, they're going to be paid, nobody was thinking about that. Now, as you start to look forward, we're really on the cusp of an entirely new set of technologies that will emerge. And so whether these specific technologies, how they're used, we don't know. But yeah. I think the opportunity is to get involved with it, understand it, and that's the key, is to understand it. And then you can begin to look at how these technologies working together create new opportunities.
Do you have any insights into like what you think some of the next kind of changes will be in business models, new scenarios?
For me, when you think about 5G and how we are becoming more and more connected. I think you're seeing new devices and things that you used to do just on a phone may move to other forms. And yep. I think that's that. What that looks like, I don't know, but I think that that's an exciting opportunity that opens up a very different way of operating in the world.
Being as early in this technology's life cycle as we were, I thought it was really important not just to invest in building a solution, but invest in building the community around this technology. And that would build depth for us and allow us to understand the real challenges of the technology, but also the real capabilities. Being a part of solving those problems allows us to be there when the walls come down and be the first ones to bring solutions forward. So I think it's a really important role to play, not just for the overall growth of the industry, but for our business to understand deeply and have a core competency in the emergence of this technology. You know, it's one thing to invest in a solution to make your business better, but it's something else entirely to invest in your business to make future solutions better.
My name is Arry Yu, and I am the chair of the Cascadia Blockchain Council with the WTIA. I think when you boil down what is humanity at its basic, it's really thinking very thoughtfully about how we work together to help each other rise.
Why do you think Cascadia is the place for blockchain to emerge? Why is this going to be the hub?
I think Seattle will be able to provide a very unique point of view. Mm-hmm. So what's the another word for a trifecta, but with four, like quadrifecta? Right, we have the enterprise and the consumer, got the startups, and then we actually have government because it's such a new realm. You know, we're dealing with data and coordination. It's going to be really important for us to have a conversation all as one, and that's kind of why we started the Cascadia Blockchain Council, to bring all these companies together so we can coordinate and have these, you know, very thoughtful conversations on how we're going to shape the future through policy advancement, right?
I think we've got some big, hairy challenges to overcome as an industry. And my fears are that those are gonna take longer than we hope. On the other side of that coin, what's really hopeful is that we have the best and brightest from the most exciting technology companies in the world dedicating themselves to this space.
Yes.
And that's all happening right here in Seattle, right?
Yes.
And that's why this is a really cool space to be exploring blockchain.
Yes. I think what scares me is complacency or just ignorance. And so,
sure.
I mean, that's why we are Cascadia Blockchain Council. We want to make sure that we're creating awareness and education.
Yeah.
We're getting people to show up, getting companies to show up and engage, getting consumers to show up and engage. You know, be aware of what you're doing online. How is this working? I'm trading my data for what? And what's going to be happening to the data? And are you taking care of my data?
We've seen a lot of different trends emerging around blockchain, but one of the really important ones is this transparency and the ability to bring light to transactions and processes that were previously fairly veiled or kind of shuttered behind an intermediary.
And one of the things that's interesting about GDPR is it really talks about the retention of this information.
Mm-hmm.
So blockchain could give us this very powerful tool where individuals would have ownership of a set of information. It seems like there's a pretty natural fit with things like GDPR where we could say, look, I have this information, I will share it with you, you can verify it. But now that the rest of that information isn't being maintained by companies who are building big databases on us.
Yeah, absolutely. It's become really important to ensure that technology we're developing meets these consumer privacy and protection requirements. And, you know, I think ethically, it's just important to make sure that we're doing that as well. We're just starting to get to the place where those solutions are being implemented. A year or 2 years ago, nobody had really even considered how we might do that.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's really cool to look forward with blockchain technology and think what the next couple of years might bring.
I think now is an exciting time because the convergence of all of these technologies opens up new opportunities we haven't even thought about.
I think blockchain will create the right kind of environment for us to create that kind of human forward, technology backed future.
There's a real significant opportunity to solve some great problems around disintermediation and decentralization of systems and how compute is moving towards the edge. These are brand new models for operating and processing, and it's going to be a really fun place to be working over the next couple of decades.